A close-up look at animal welfare issues is supported by animalwelfareissues.com.
You are watching A Close-Up Look at Animal Welfare Issues with your host, writer, speaker, and advocate, Tina Evangelista-Eppenstein. This show is supported in part by animalwelfareissues.com, spotlighting issues around the globe. Check out the latest TV shows, articles, podcasts, and more. That's animalwelfareissues.com. Now here's your host, Tina, in 3, 2, 1.
Food, you know, I just couldn't stop thinking about it.
So
you know, I went to the fridge and I opened up the meat drawer. You know what the meat drawer is, right?
Yeah. What was in there?
Well, I'll tell you what was in there. You know that bacon that's like maple? It's got maple flavor.
The maple kind, yeah.
Yeah, so
yeah,
I took that out and I thought,
yeah,
I know who would like that. Me. So I ate it.
Oh no. You're kidding me.
Nope. Not kidding. You know, I also noticed there was some beef in there. Yeah, you know, steak, you know, juicy. Well, I ate that, too. But I went back to the fridge just a few minutes ago, and I put something together really special. You're going to love this one. I took some chicken.
Yeah.
I put some cheese on it, and I covered it with...
Covered it with what?
I covered it with cat treats.
Yeah.
Then guess what?
What?
I gave it to the cat.
Hey, I did not turn into Clark the Talking Dog. This is me, Tina Evangelista-Eppenstein, and thanks for tuning in for this program. And on today's program, we're going to go for something different. And I just want to talk about Clark there in the beginning. Clark G, the talking dog, he had gone viral with that particular video quite a few years ago, but I had just seen it the other week and I thought I wanted to share it with the audience here for anybody who's watching, because I think Clark is hilarious. And his family made this video, and one of the, I think it was an uncle named Andrew, who actually did Clark's voice, and I have to give kudos to him. He did a fantastic job. But Clark's talents were used by advertisers using that same video, but I just thought we'd start the show on a funny note. But you know what? Let's get to some news right now. And in the news right now is a spotted lantern fly. And the spotted lantern fly, and if we could just show, I think I have a picture. Okay, just keep on there. And it is a really pretty insect with the red wings. But it can be so deadly and is deadly to the different plants and trees around here. Right, okay. To the different plants and trees around here. And the population I think they were expecting here, I don't know. It hasn't come, right? It started. I mean, we're just seeing them now. These guys, they were in their nymph stage before, and now we're seeing them flying around. In fact, I mean, just last week, I mean, I was looking up in the sky in my backyard after releasing some butterflies, and wow, I mean, just one by one by one, they were just all flying around. They're landing on buildings, and I did see more last year. They originated from China, India, and Vietnam, and they go after our grapes. And they're trying to get them away from Erie County right now. They said that most likely will not happen. And 70% of grapes come from Erie County in Pennsylvania, and they make the wine. So I guess what I really want to talk about, two things about the spotted lantern fly. They're pretty, but deadly. Two things. There's a woman in the Lehigh Valley, and I apologize, I had her name, and I don't have it in front of me right now. She's doing some artwork, and she has private citizens involved. And just staying there, she takes the dead lantern flies and She helps people after they harvest them, means after they are killed, and they're told to freeze them for a couple of days. They bring them in to her and as a group, and they are creating all these murals, and they're tearing off their wings, and the red wings, the outside wings, and this, they are creating artwork, and it's murals all over the place. And isn't that kind of weird? Yeah, people are doing it, they like it. I don't know. I'm finding other people who don't have any knowledge of this, they're finding it strange, creepy, weird. It's up to you, the viewer, how you see it. They want to bring attention to it. I don't know. It's not something I personally would participate in, but I guess art is in the eye of the beholder. I don't know where they're going to have this, but I think they're still making the murals. There's quite a few murals, and I don't know when this goes on display yet, but it's something interesting, I guess, to see, if you want to see that. But regarding the spotted lantern fly in Philadelphia, now a couple weeks ago, they started showing up as well there too, as the adult spotted lantern fly. And what's funny, people were getting really worked up over this. It was in the news that the spotted lantern fly had reached there. Well, if you can show the tweet from the Philadelphia police, the Philadelphia police were getting so many phone calls, they put out a tweet. And it says, please do not call 911 to report spotted lantern fly sightings. While they are a nuisance, they are not a police issue. So, and they try to be funny. And on that note, we for one would like to welcome our new insect overlords. Maybe they would like to build some nests on our vast concrete headquarters, and people got they thought that was funny. They got a chuckle out of that, and the comments on there said as much. I don't think someone understood that, but for what it's worth, don't call 911 if you see spotted lantern flies. Who do you call?
Penn State Extension.
The Penn State Extension.
Or the Ag Department.
Of the Department of Ag?
Yeah.
Okay, and you can Google that. But if you... Are we supposed to report all spotted lantern flies if we see them?
Only outside the quarantine area.
Quarantine areas. Now, there are several counties that are quarantined in the state of Pennsylvania, southeastern Pennsylvania, basically.
Yeah.
With Berks included in there. And Lancaster, I think.
And it's leaked out of state.
And what?
It actually went out of state now.
It has gone out of state?
A little bit in Delaware, a little bit in Maryland. Yeah.
A little bit in Delaware. Okay. So... they should call their own Department of Ag there.
Exactly.
So, but if you see them, I mean, they're going to tell you to kill them. You know, right. I mean, what can you do at this point? But if you see them and if you have a problem with them, don't call the police. Call Penn State Extension, the Department of Ag. So, there you go. Some interesting little tidbits about the spotted lantern fly. I want to go to, on a sadder note, to Beulah. Beulah was a 54-year-old elephant, and she recently died. If we could roll the tape, and you can hear
Biggie
a little bit
more about Biggie confirmed today that Beulah the elephant has died.
Her presence at New England's Great State Fair has garnered a lot of controversy and protests over the years. 22 News anchor Don Shipman live at the Big E after speaking with workers at the petting zoo.
News of Beulah's death traveled fast here at the fair today. I was over at the petting zoo earlier this evening. It's actually right down that way, down near gate 4 of the Big E. And one of the workers told me that they're taking Beulah's death pretty hard. Tim Comerford of Comerford Farms, Beulah's owner, didn't want to talk to the media, but through a worker, he said that he'd release a statement at some point later this evening. A spokesperson for the Big E said that Beulah died of natural causes. Catherine Pappas told 22 News that elephant returned to R.W. Comerford Farms in Goshen, Connecticut, but didn't specify when. So at this point, we don't know when the elephant died. I can tell you, though, that over the weekend, a member of the 22 News staff saw an elephant in the petting zoo area with a sign out front that read Beulah. And in a statement to 22 News, the president of the Big E, Gene Cassidy, said that his team is heartbroken. He said, and I'm quoting here, "If you truly loved Beulah, kindly remember her and the Comerford family in your thoughts and prayers. They have lost a loved one." Now, there's been some controversy each year with this farm bringing animals to the Big E. This year, the Western Massachusetts Animal Rights Advocates Group continued their protests of the animals here at the Big E just outside the fair gates. So again, as of right now, no elephants over there at the petting zoo. But I can tell you there is still a camel there, and they also have some miniature horses. Live here at the Big E, Don Shipman, 22 News.
Yes, we're back here, close up look at animal welfare issues. You just got done watching about Beulah the elephant. As I said, she was 54 years old, and I have seen other footage. And actually, I saw a picture of Beulah. She had collapsed a couple of times the week before she died. And a news reporter was there, and they captured the photo. So it wasn't doctored. Well, I want to say it wasn't doctored. No, it wasn't doctored. In the footage I had seen, Beulah looked really worn out and tired while she was carrying, you know, somebody on her back. And that didn't look good to me. And she collapsed. I mean, this family has come under attack previously. They have three elephants, and they also have camels. And I think they are giving rides to camels. But they have been come under protest prior to Beulah's death for doing this, for using the elephants all of these years. And some say the USDA did cite them, but activists have actively been protesting this family for years for them to stop this. My personal opinion is I can't see using wild animals for a ride. I mean, I think it's cool to see an elephant, but in its natural surroundings, I don't think they should be used for fun. And so it's really, really sad that they're saying, you know, they did not mistreat Beulah and that she was part of the family. Other people see it another way. It's just sad that she had to live her life out like this, you know, just going, I guess, from one place to another, giving rides to kids. And I'm not sure about adults. She seemed like a smaller elephant to me. But as I said, they also use camels. Which brings me to my next story. And I had just gotten this story but before I came here to do this show. And to me, it's stupidity and hysterical. At the Tiger Truck Stop, I believe it's in Texas. And Tiger the Truck Stop became famous a number of years ago, and I've written about her, talked about Tiger. He was stuck at this truck stop. He lived there. And activists, again, were protesting Tiger's enclosure, and they wanted him to be freed. And the owner, he had his vet kept saying Tiger was fine. The Animal Legal Defense Fund wanted to free Tiger. So did other people. Tiger was never freed until his death in 2017. Now, at this place, they have other animals, and that includes a camel. And this couple was there, I guess, over the weekend. And they stopped at this truck stop, which is also like a petting zoo, a roadside zoo. And they had their dog out. And they decided, the husband decided, I'm going to throw some treats to my dog, to my unleashed dog. But he threw them, for whatever reason, underneath the camel's fence. I don't know why. The camel can't get out underneath the fence, but I don't know why there was a raised fence. So he threw them underneath the fence, and yes, their dog went underneath the fence. And yes, this couple went underneath the fence to get their dog. Excuse me. And in the process, this camel was getting irritated. The dog went up to the camel. I don't know if the camel became agitated. But I don't think he became as agitated with the dog as he did with the couple, because he sat on the wife. And the wife, not knowing what to do, got upset. She was angry. So what do you do when you have a camel sitting on you and it's like you don't know how to get him off of you? You bite his testicles. And so she bit, sorry. She bit his testicles.
Did he get it off? No pun
intended. Boom. But she did. Didn't scream for help, but like I said, she bit his testicle. I don't know how they got the camel off of her, but the dog is fine. But this couple was cited for having an unleashed dog for trespassing. Now looking back, the husband said, he didn't know what he was thinking when he threw the treats underneath the camel's fence. But I mean, come on, people. I mean, that's pure stupidity, but it's also hysterical when you bite a camel's testicles to get him off of you. I don't know. People, use your heads. Don't go in a camel's enclosure. Get help inside. They said they gladly would have helped her. They said all she had to do was go inside. I'm telling you, people never cease to amaze me and the things that they do. How much time do we have left, by the way?
About 10.
10, okay. I was going to talk about one of my least favorite people. Maybe I'll just show the video of Kanye West and Kim. Can we just show that?
Park, right?
The moral of that story, they were in Wyoming and they were harassing the antelope. What are they called?
Pronghorns,
but also known as antelope. And you cannot do that. You cannot harass wild animals. And they were not cited, but they were reprimanded by the Wyoming Fish and Game Commission. So reprimanded. They didn't get a ticket or anything, but you cannot go around harassing animals. And apparently according to Kanye West and his wife, that they said that he did slow down or he stopped or something so that they could pass. We didn't see that, but still, you don't want to go around harassing the animals. That's all I really want to say about those two. I do want to go to a woman. This story did happen a few months ago, but let me tell you, this has happened periodically. And it's a disturbing story to me. A woman in Virginia died, and in her will, she asked her executors to have her dog euthanized and placed with her in her casket when she got buried. Can you roll that tape and we'll come back?
In the always crowded Chesterfield Animal Shelter, surrounded by strays and cast-offs, sat a very special dog. Not your typical pound puppy or mongrel, but a well-bred animal that looked much like this one. She was a pampered and much-loved dog. In fact, you might say she was loved to death. Emma arrived at the shelter March 8th. And during her two-week stay, shelter personnel had several discussions with representatives of the dead woman's estate, trying to talk them out of euthanizing this dog so she could be laid to rest with her master, but to no avail. The minute Emma left the shelter, she was taken to a local vet and put down, leaving shelter workers heartbroken.
We did suggest to them that they could sign the dog over on numerous occasions, you know, because it's a dog that we could easily find a home for and rehome it. But ultimately, they came back in on March 22nd and redeemed the dog back.
After Emma was euthanized, her remains were taken to a local pet cremation center. Her ashes were then placed in an urn and returned to the authorized representative of the estate, all in accordance with the dead woman's will.
It's not legal to put a dog, cremated remains, or an animal in a casket and bury them.
Meet Larry Spiaggi. Now,
with this.
He's president of the Virginia Funeral Directors Association and owner of Morissette Funeral and Cremation Services.
Come here.
When you walk into his funeral home, you'll probably be greeted by one of Larry's chocolate labs. This fella's name is Peace. He has free run of the place. And while he is Larry's personal pet, Peace is also a highly trained and certified therapy dog. He's there to help clients through their grief. You'd be hard-pressed to find a funeral director more pet-friendly than this one. Just don't ask him to slip Rover's cremated remains in Grandma's casket, because he won't do it.
I am licensed by the state of Virginia, so I have a license on the line with the Health Professions Board, so I cannot do it.
And finding a vet to euthanize a healthy dog or cat won't be easy. Pets are personal property in the eyes of the law, and putting down a healthy dog or cat is by no means illegal.
All right, sweetie.
Still, many vets have ethical issues with it.
Whenever we're faced with euthanasia, it's a very emotional situation, and beyond everything that we talk about that we need to do ethically and that we've taken an oath to do, it's something we take home, too. You know, it weighs on us as professionals.
But he does real well. And
Larry knows where he's coming from. Many years ago, before the law changed, he helped make arrangements for a client who wanted her elderly dog euthanized and buried with her in the casket. It's something that still haunts Larry to this day.
And knowing that, you know, while we were taking care of her, that poor dog was being euthanized, you know, I still, even after I saw his temperament and everything, I still ached over it, you know.
So I think this is really disturbing to take a healthy dog and to euthanize that dog. And the thing is, the dog could not be placed with the owner anyway, according to their laws. But no one knows actually what happened to the dog's ashes in the end, because private and family cemeteries, you are allowed to bury the people with their pets. Even some pet cemeteries in the United States, 50 pet cemeteries, allow people to be buried in the same cemetery as their pet. But it's just so sad to take a healthy dog to euthanize them. You know, a healthy dog and no pleading with the family to rehome the dog and to give this dog, you know, a chance. I mean, you know, would you do that to our Brody?
No, never.
You know, it's like, I mean, that healthy dog could have lived. I mean, I find it selfish, and maybe she thought there was nobody out there. Maybe she didn't know of anyone. Maybe she was alone. I don't know. But find somebody before you die. Because we are taking steps to do that in case anything would happen to us, to have our Brody taken care of and any other pets. So you want to take care of that beforehand, because it's just really, I don't know. You know, people, you know, don't like this, but I'm sorry, I don't agree with it. And the last thing I want to talk about, Pennsylvania has held monarch migration events, and other states are having them. As the monarchs migrate south, they are holding more events, because the monarchs are migrating only from Canada, North America, down to Mexico, where they were over winter from I don't know, December, January till March, something like that, April. But my husband and I have reared, so far, as of today, 535 monarchs. And we will hit like 560 or over 560 some by the time we're done. Right there, just hold that. In that shot, I mean, there are a total of 25 monarchs. They're not all in that shot, but that is right before we release them. I take the photographs, and they were all raring to go, all healthy monarchs. And we had three sets of 25, and it's really cool sight to see when you see them go up. And sometimes they don't go up, and then we put them on, or they fly on one of our nectar plants, if you could show that. And we had about 9 or 10 of them, and they just kept feeding, and they feed until they're ready to go. But if they're not ready to go, we'll keep them just overnight, and then we release them the next day when they're really ready to go. But our nectar plants have also brought in some other types of butterflies. If you could just put one up, and I can tell you what it is. What is this?
Red-spotted purple.
The red-spotted purple. I'm sorry. I just couldn't see it. Do I have another one of that? I mean, these are gorgeous. Black, blue, red. We had never seen this before, but came into our yard. And then after that, we saw there's a couple swallowtails. This is the tiger swallowtail. This came the other week. And then there's one more. This is the giant swallowtail. This is giant. This is not common. And this is near the end of his or her life. I don't know how to sex this one. But you can see, like, half the feathers are gone. And I was watching him or her, and I could see, you know, it was really just going slow, but gliding around. But that is just really not common. And it came in our yard, and we had another butterfly come in our yard the other day, which I did not get to bring the picture here. My husband got the picture. A gorgeous butterfly. But if you put out nectar plants, they will come. So here's hoping all the monarchs, you know, come out very well. Thanks for tuning in. And remember, don't bite a camel's testicles to get them off of you. So thanks for tuning in. This is Tina Evangelista-Eppenstein. We'll see you next time.
A close-up look at animal welfare issues is supported by animalwelfareissues.com.